As you know, President Sarkozy from France expressed some very strong views on that sector, and actually identified the Barbados jurisdiction by name. And of course, 2 years earlier, we had the OECD, which, by the way, made this Paris. So we realize that naturally, if these North Atlantic countries are having pressure, whether it's debt or just generally pressure, fiscal accounts in terms of paying for government goods and services and the like, it is only obvious that jurisdictions that are going to, that are set up expressly to, for people to not evade, but avoid paying the level of taxation they would pay in their, in the countries they operate, that they're going to target them and deal with them. Their loss is our gain. And it is going to be a rocky road for the international business sector. And that is not only related to the Eurozone crisis, but generally speaking. Years ago, there was something called foreign sales cooperation, that a lot of US companies were setting the FSC in Barbados. They changed, Congress changed the law, and that was the end of that. FSC went to nil. And that is the reality of the international business sector, where it's a highly challenged environment and arena. And once again, the approach to dealing with that is the identical approach that we're taking at tourism. You have to look for alternative sources of business and going to other jurisdictions. And yes, China, the people who are making all the money, who have money, who have profits, who have savings, and who are looking for investment instruments and the like, that is where we have to go and offer those goods and services. So I think that is really truly the fundamental message that I can leave with you today. The Eurozone crisis is nothing for us to panic over. I don't think that even what's happening globally is anything for us to panic necessarily. I know one or two people are a little concerned about the Middle East situation. You know, this wrangling with Iran over the whether the uranium is being enriched to generate power or enriched to weapons grade and so on, and whether there may be another set of conflict now in that particular area. And we all know that there are usually consequences for the global economy and consequences of travel and tourism when we have that kind of stability around. But you know, I think we can prevail. We've prevailed before. We have fared many challenges, and we have come out on top. It is very encouraging when I travel representing Barbados to hear what we are told constantly by our partners and by persons who are looking to do business. And that is the very high regard that Barbados has in. And anytime you the people who come here regularly, they will tell you the same thing. What they like most about Barbados is, in fact, the people, the occupants. This is a wonderful island that we have here, and we have to continue to protect it, we have to continue to preserve it. And the truth is that if we continue along those lines, not only will it be a better place for all of us to live, but it will be a better place for all of our friends from abroad to visit, and of course our friends abroad to do business with. So tourism will benefit, the national sector will benefit, and we can continue to grow from strength. I have already said it, and I believe, therefore, that our approach to dealing with the global crises as they come up is to be found right in the words uttered by our founding father, whose birthday we will be recognized in another week. And that, I think, is about an appropriate note for me to end this particular portion of my address. And that is to say that the best way to deal with the situation is for us to continue friends of all, and that, like, you want to raise the I remember when we were in opposition, and we discussed it. You have to understand these agencies, these rating agencies, are investor rating agencies. So whether it is Standard & Poor's, Moody's, Fitch, but we're trying to start writing about, you know, the agencies, but these agencies are about investor rating. So, for example, Botswana has a higher investment rating than Barbados, but their mineral wealth is diamond itself, and they're relatively well run as a country, a good strong central bank as well. But Botswana is a country that is ravaged by HIV/AIDS, and up to 2 years ago, the average life expectancy was in the low 40s. So, you know. You know, Joe, it's tickling stuff about mismeasuring our lives and getting too caught up sometimes with GDP and per capita income and the like. So let us put these ratings in context. I'm not saying it isn't important, because certainly when you're looking to borrow money and the like, the banks will look at your investment rate to determine, you know, the interest rate and so on. It's not something you should ignore. But it's something to put in correct context. I mean, Standard & Poor's talks about our GDP being greater than 100%. What they're not talking about, Japan is over 200%. You know, we of course, there are reasons why that would not be as much a factor. But I'm just saying, I think that we need to give it appropriate context. Having said that, I think that the government of Barbados is on track when we try to control costs and not take on debt willy-nilly, maintain a reasonable debt to GDP ratio. That's one of the main things that these agencies look at. We continue to be a well-run, a well-organized society, and we continue to do those things that are right, and the investment grade will take care of itself. That's how I see it, and it doesn't dominate anything that I do. It's something I'm aware of. I have a television set in my office at Bloomberg, and yes, I monitor what's going on, but it is still, we still have to maintain our focus on what. Mm-hmm. Well, let me just first of all say Barbados is not really a threat. Far from. We are actually one of the safest places to visit in the whole Caribbean, in fact, in the entire world. And you will hear, you know, safety and security is one of our brand elements. And anyone saying that on a vessel or on an aircraft or anywhere is just being mischievous. I'm not going to tell you we're crazy. We have had issues, and we deal with them as expeditiously and as sensitively as we can. But it is just not true to say we are crime ridden. You know, this, you hear different things and so on, and I guess you have to know how to separate the forest from the trees.
The second question has to do with the emerging markets in great countries. And we know at least certainly with Brazil and China, we have ambassadorial presence from China. And we have the earliest and so on, and the Brazil, I think they just established an embassy there. Could you say, so far, how Barbados has benefited in whatever sector having ambassadorial presence in these two emerging BRIC countries, and what plans would you say that you have, or the government as a whole has, in terms of establishing presence in the other two BRIC countries, which is India and Russia, given that the four of them collectively contribute to more than one-sixth of the world's population?
Well, I mean, the issue of expanding our network of embassies is one that is obviously constrained by the cost. China and Brazil were strategically against sight. And I think that what we can hope to do, and that has been done, the expanding network of honorary consuls, mm-hmm. so you don't necessarily have the cost, but you still have the reputation. Mm-hmm. And that that is something that has, been improved quite a bit. I noticed that Sam and the team have been doing some work in that regard in terms of, you know, sometimes replacing persons who maybe, you know, for one reason or another, no longer have the interest or the capacity to continue. And of course, naming honorary counsel in those places we would like to touch. But, you know, we have to continue to do that. From our electoralism, we certainly leverage the fact where there is representation, but there's nothing to stop us from stepping out. In India, we don't have a high commission in India, as to some of our neighbors in Trinidad at the moment. But we can still talk to them, given the Commonwealth connection, the level of cricket acceptance, on some possibilities. I mean, we've had some initial discussions, and I think that at some time in the future, you will see some sort of direct connection here. I'm not talking about a one-off or World Cup costing $600,000. I'm talking about a more serious scenario. There are some other players in aviation in India now. It's no longer just Air India, and some of them have indicated the desire to come to this part of the world. So we'll continue talking to them.
Thank you very much.
Ms. Spencer, first one, you said that expanding to different areas, South America, China, India, these other places. But will these people be coming for the same reasons that our traditional people come? And what changes, what plans, what preparations do they have to make in order to, so that when they come, they will have a satisfying experience?
That's a very good question. The first part of your question is, yes, they're coming for the same reason. They want to enjoy the wonderful climate, wonderful culinary offerings, wonderful people, beautiful beaches. They want to enjoy the heritage. They want to take part in sports, tourism, events. They want to come for all of those reasons. But you were quite right when you said about preparing. There are some cultural differences. Latin Americans, as you know, they, around this time, they've gone home to get a rest. So they tend to have dinner very late. So around the time, the average Barbadian restaurant worker is going to wash up and cream and get ready to go home. It's time that some of these people are looking to go and have dinner. And that's the reality. And some of these things, you know, we have discussed with the private sector players, and we have to realize, well, look, if you want the business, you have to make some adjustments. The other thing is, of course, that Brazilians especially, they are not so big into the English speaking. You might find some of the Spanish speaking elements of Latin America maybe into English, bigger than the Brazilians. You've got to have some Portuguese people in the ground if you want to have major business there. We have been able to get the classes going. I think that it is encouraging to hear that the efforts to teach Portuguese, or should I say Brazilian Portuguese, but apparently there's a difference between the two. There's Portuguese, and there's Brazilian Portuguese. So the classes have been oversubscribed. The HTA members and so have responded well. And I think that is a good sign. But you're quite right. We have to be aware of the cultural nuances, and we have to also have the Portuguese speakers. As far as China, same thing. You got to have, you know, Mandarin and Cantonese speakers, depending on where they're coming from. And there may be some cultural nuances that we need to be conscious of and to minister to that if we're going to be serious about going after that. Certainly where we are concerned, all of our collateral. We have no need to ensure not only the websites, but the brochures and so on, the information, bits and pieces that we give our business. We have to have them translated into Brazilian Portuguese, and that is where we're getting business from. Last year we had just under 4,500 Brazilians came to 2011. That was double the number that came in 2010. Of course, the dog strike started in June 2010. So the first full year of the strike we had was 2011. And so far, the numbers, when we compare the first run of the strike to the second run, that is 2010-2011, they have increased by 34%. So we're going in the right direction. We signed on Nascimento, which is a huge Brazilian tour operator, and they're actually booking part of the flight, so there's less seats for us to fill generally, and that means that we are be on the road. It's going to take a few years to become a full-fledged, legitimate source market. It will probably not be a major source market until a few more years, but I think we're going in the right direction.
And you brought up the thing about Canada, that it was our number one journey to ever get that right. We also have Scandinavian at the same time, and also during the 90s in the July to September period, the Irish. Are any steps going to be taken to recover Scandinavian and Irish along with Canada?
Yes, we've already started in Scandinavia with Three Nordic, Nova Stockholm, and many of those visitors are actually, they're from Finland, they're from other parts of Scandinavia, Norway, and so on, and connecting through Stockholm. From next year, they will have the option to do either Stockholm or Helsinki. So we are fearful that Scandinavian business. And let me just say very quickly, I know you will be aware of this, but they're not a very populous country. Populations are small. However, they have done very well. Export-led economies, particularly in automobiles and cell phones and other technology. And it therefore means that the disposable income is relatively high, and it is a, and there are people who will travel for long distances for vacation, and therefore it's very good business. And the overwhelming success of the charter this year, after such a long break, tells us that we are in fact onto something and going in the right direction. So we definitely want to see Scandinavian business pick back up. Fortunately, Scandinavians, generally speaking, will speak English, so some of the challenges we may have with Chinese or Russian or Brazilian visitors, we may not have to the same extent with the Scandinavians, to some extent, yes, but as Senator Jiltz was telling, many of them do speak English very well. He used to interact quite a bit with so we do in fact see it that way, and we would love to see those numbers start to climb back up. I like the fact that they tend to stay longer periods as well, and it is interesting too that even though many of them, yes, we'll want to stay in the traditional hotels, quite a few of them opt to go south coast into the indigenously owned properties, smaller properties, and so forth, and which is a very, very important fact. You know, we can't forget the small and medium-sized properties that need boost, and for some reason, the Europeans and Scandinavians in particular seem to like that type of property. And that's good business, therefore, for us to get out of
the British. We all live in. Yeah, the only other thing I wanted to know is how is Barbados progressing with the preparations when Brazil has their World Cup? Especially being that we have flights with Brazil now, how will we capitalize on that?
Well, it means a couple of things. It means that Brazilians that want to get out of Brazil for the World Cup will come here directly. And Barbadians, who I presume will want to go and see the World Cup, can do so on a direct. Like we did raise it with golf. I mean, I warned them that for some reason, Brazil is the team that most Barbadians are and their work that we support. And I'm sure that many of them will want to experience the work up. And there's nothing to stop them from using God. And let me also add that you don't have to wait until we work up. I used to go and see that fascinating country. One of the things that helps us to keep the flights going is when we can have business going the other direction as well. The reason that we have 2 flights a day from Miami on American Airlines isn't only because of tourism business, but it is because of the business that goes north from Barbados, from our neighbors. And it helps if we have business going in both directions, it makes the flight that much more viable. I have recommended publicly, and I will repeat it here, that, you know, instead of going to Miami all the time, spending on vacation and, you know, spending money at malls and coming back here broke, you can go to Brazil and see a fascinating country. Ambassador Morris will tell you the second largest black population in the whole world after Nigeria, the next most country with the largest black population in Brazil. And that is, and not only that, a culturally remarkable place, and I think that, you know, that is something that we can look at. World Cup would be a huge magnet, I'm sure, the World Cup of football, and for that matter, the Olympics in 2016. Brazil is going to be hosting the Olympics after London. So they have the World Cup in 2014 and the Olympics in